French oscillating turrets. They're quite iconic, aren't they? Well, believe it or not, the French were not the only ones experimenting with this technology. Introducing Mr. Kranvagn, or KRV. This is a Swedish tank, one with an intriguing story. A story which I'm about to tell you in today's video. After World War II, Sweden was, to put it mildly, lacking in terms of military vehicles. Especially their tanks were hopelessly obsolete. They had stuff like the Landsberg L60, which were really just not gonna do it. In 1943, the Swedes got their hands on the Soviet T-34 tank, provided by Finland, which has multiple T-34s as trophies. This gave the Swedes another reminder of how outdated their tanks had become. But there was one vehicle in particular that caused a lot of concern. And some of you might already know which tank I'm talking about, the dreaded Joseph Stalin III, or IS-3. Now this vehicle was a huge jump scare to the whole world, especially America, but this is not the Halloween special, so we can talk about that in another video. Let's only focus on the Swedish reaction to the vehicle. The Swedish military was quite shocked by this thing, but their reaction was certainly pretty late, as they found out about the thing in March of 1950. They realized that they were helpless and doomed by this new bear. And this was one of the main factors driving the KRV project, to find a weapon capable of defeating the IS-3. That was the ultimate goal. Sweden lacked knowledge of modern tanks. They started looking to other nations to study foreign equipment, most noticeably a German Tiger II tank. This was one of the most technologically advanced tanks of World War II. It was provided by the French, who hoped to get a military cooperation out of it with Sweden. And this cooperation would happen. France would start to share a lot of stuff with Sweden, even showing its own prototypes and new stuff like the AMX-50. The Swedes studied this very carefully, obtaining a lot of knowledge. They studied the AMX-50 and the AMX-120. Besides taking inspiration from both of these, German tanks also influenced the design. But another interesting thing is the way the Swedes designed this thing. Instead of following global trends, they made a vehicle specifically for Sweden. They designed it to work with the hilly terrain of the country in mind and for military operations in Sweden. The vehicle had to be relatively small and light, as the AMX-50 weighed well over 50 tons, which was way too much for Sweden. They were, however, very interested in the special turret the AMX had, the oscillating turret. In addition, the ammunition was to be stored in an overhanging rear turret bustle, with it being fitted with an autoloader. Autoloaders were a new concept developed by France, something the Swedes were once again very interested in. The armor layout was also something of note, as the AMX had strong frontal armor but very thin sides. Sweden would start making its own stuff now, making a tank known as Emil. This was totally different than other Swedish tanks. Unlike their most recent failure, the Stridsvagen M42, the Swedes wanted this thing to be full of cutting-edge technology. This Emil is a bit different than the Kranvagen. The tank was supposed to be small, with good mobility and low mass. It had a low profile and oscillating turret inspired by France. The gun it used was a 120mm L40 gun with its requested autoloader. The relatively short barrel was due to the fact that the Emil was going to be firing heat shells. The autoloader could provide the Emil with a rate of fire of up to 40 rounds per minute. These powerful shells had the capability of destroying the IS-3, the tank which was just as terrifying as the person it was named after. It had a heavy weight of 28 tons, but that would make it a heavy tank, with very thick armor. The hull would have roughly 120mm and the turret would have a solid 170mm. Due to its small size, it was powered by a 550 horsepower Volvo engine. Though being an oscillating turret, it was actually quite unique. It worked differently than its French counterpart. The turret of the AMX was split in two, the bottom and upper section. The bottom part of an oscillating turret is for traversing the turret, and the upper part is for housing the gun and the autoloader. The front of the Emil turret was fixed in place, with the gun barrel poking through it. This gave many benefits as it was hereby extremely well protected, and this also reduced the chance of turret being jammed. In addition, the tank had excellent gun depression angle of minus 14 degrees, which allowed it to work with the Swedish terrain. However, the Swedish military kept increasing the requirements. While this project began in the late 1940s, by 1952 the vehicle had reached 35 tons and grew in size. Here's where we face one of the problems the tank had. The prototype would not be finished until 1955 and mass production could not begin until 1958. Therefore, this Emil prototype was rejected. Another factor contributing to its cancellation was the 120mm gun. According to the military, it was too weak. They instead went with the heaviest Emil E3 project, equipped with a 150mm gun. Naturally, there were also Emil E1 and E2 projects. We know their statistics, but no blueprints seem to be around. E2 was also armed with the 15cm gun, but the E1 would use a 120mm gun. The E2 and E3 mainly differ in the engine they would use. The 15cm gun would still fire powerful heat shells and be 60 calibers long. The gun depression angle would change to minus 12 degrees, which is still pretty good. The E3 design was also heavily reworked. It now used a pike nose style armor layout similar to the IS-3. This decision was made in 1952, and these blueprints from 1954 showed the pike nose. The following year, Sweden wanted to buy AMX 30 tanks from France, but they realized that these tanks did not fit the Swedish terrain. Sweden was desperate for tanks, and they really needed them fast. So negotiations with Britain led to the Swedes purchasing Centurion Mark III tanks. While being far from ideal, it was still a tank and a reasonably modern one too. This would shift a lot of the interest away from the KRV project. However, work on the KRV project would continue. But it was hardly the same tank it was originally. It had a bigger gun, thicker armor, different wheels, and a number of different engines were tried. This presents another problem, as the tank was now approaching over 40 tons. The engines Sweden had were not able to provide enough power to such a tank. Therefore, Sweden arranged a deal with US company Continental Motors. They would use more powerful engines of 810 horsepower. The hull armor was also increased to 145mm, while the frontal turret armor remained 170mm, with the sides and rear being 70 and 40mm thick respectively. In 1954, all the plans for the vehicle were complete. It's too bad for it, the thing had a little future as a tank by now, but it was still highly classified. Here's the point where it received its new and iconic codename, Kranvagn, translating to mobile crane. Compared to the Centurion tank, it weighed almost as much while being smaller and having more armor and a powerful engine. Two companies worked on the tank, Bofors and Landsverk. Bofors was designing the turret and weapon system, and Landsverk tackled the running gear. Landsverk managed to complete the hull. Unfortunately, things did not go so smooth for the turret. The engineers and designers had trouble incorporating the autoloader and the stabilization system. The heat shells were also pretty tricky to work with. When the time came to test the KRV, its turret and gun simply weren't ready yet. Therefore, the Kranvagn received a dummy turret. It was equal in weight and dimensions, and with this, the hull of the Kranvagn could begin testing. The running gear was fine, there were no issues with it. The engine gave good mobility of roughly 60 km per hour, and the armor was pretty thick. To put this into perspective, the 145mm pike nose was sloped at such an angle that could sustain hits better than the IS-7, without a doubt the most technologically advanced tanks the Soviets had. But with it having no turret, the Swedes wondered what to do with their new vehicle. It's kinda useless at this point, not gonna lie. There was this idea floating around of putting the turret of the Centurion Mark X onto the chassis. This would not have been a half bad idea, as the 105mm L7 gun and the turret of the Centurion were both pretty good. But the military decided to just buy the Centurion Mark X tanks in their entirety instead of just the turrets. This would put an end to the project and the Kranvagn was cancelled. The tank turned out to be too modern for its time. The ever increasing requirements led to the eventual end of the project. It's possible that if Sweden had chosen to build a male variant of the tank, they would have been able to complete the vehicle. It would probably have been one of the most impressive vehicles produced by Western engineers. But it would not have mattered anyway, as the IS-3 was claimed to be obsolete by the Soviet military in 1946. Therefore, the Swedes were building a tank for battles which would never even happen. Moreover, if the vehicle would have ended up being completed, another issue is the fact that the tank would end up being far too expensive. In the end, the T-54 and T-55 were the real threats, but the British Centurion tanks were more than able to deal with these rivals. The Kranvagn may have never become the tank the designers envisioned it to be, but all work on the project was not in vain. The Swedes learned valuable lessons from the project and gained a lot of experience. The chassis was tested further, and one of the two chassis served as the basis for the AKV-151 SPG prototype. The hull was converted to allow a new artillery system to be mounted onto it. The engineers would later design a loading system for it, similar to the one which was supposed to be carried by the Kranvagn. This loading system was later used by the Band Cannon 1, an improved version of the AKV-151 SPG. This thing achieved a rate of fire which is most impressive, 14 rounds every 45 seconds. This was really peak for its time. This artillery piece would see service until 2003. The Kranvagn also played a role in the design of the famous S-Tank. The other hull was used as a test rig for the STRV-103. The STRV-103 definitely has an appearance just as unique as the Kranvagn, but it achieved far more success than the KRV. Once again showing that good old school sloped armor will never go out of fashion. Unfortunately, without it ever receiving a turret or even a finalized armament, we can never state with certainty how good the Kranvagn would have been. But frontally, especially when it would hide its hull, it would have been a formidable opponent for any tank to face during combat. The hull used for the test with the STRV-103 is still around today. It's safely stored in the Swedish Tank Museum, better known as Arsenalen. The museum has lots of other cool and interesting Swedish tanks. I would definitely recommend it to people living nearby to check it out. I will too. Well, one day. Hopefully. In the future. Anyway, that's it for the story of the Kranvagn. What started out as a mail tank would turn into a crane truck. The Swedish archive seems to have failed at preserving most of the blueprints, but hopefully this video gives everyone some information about this Swedish war machine and what it could have been. The Kranvagn just so happens to be one of my personal favorite tanks, because it's, you know, it has an interesting story and unique looks. So I hope you enjoyed. If you did, feel free to subscribe, like and share this video, and maybe you could check out some of my other stuff while you're at it. And ciao! I guess, wow, that did not sound as cool as I thought it would.